Hi, and welcome back to Windows Azure Week. I'm Miranda Luna. I'm a product manager on the Windows Azure mobile team and was here with you for the Notification Hubs overview. And now I am joined by my good buddy, Kirill.
Thank you, Miranda. I'm Kirill Gavriluk. I'm the lead program manager on Windows Azure mobile team, responsible for mobile services and Notification Hubs.
So we started the day out today, if you were with us at first, going over Notification Hubs so that you had something actionable you could use to put into your existing apps today. Now we're going to take a step back and say, okay, well, if you're looking to build a new scalable mobile application, or maybe add a mobility layer to an application you already have, what are your options for doing that in Azure, and how can different services help? Primarily, we're going to be looking at Windows Azure Mobile Services, and we're also going to cover a little bit of Notification Hubs in the consumer scenario. We're going to cover the different features in mobile services that help with consumer-facing mobile applications and the need to be super scalable. So today, what we're going to be doing is we're going to have a quick overview of what it means to host a mobile backend in Azure. For those of you who joined us in the first session, it's going to be a little bit of review, but important to set that for all of our new friends. Then we're going to move on to supported platforms in mobile services, and then take a little bit of a deep dive into data, authentication, and push notifications. And then end by taking a look at extensibility before we again cover best practices and point you towards some resources that should be helpful. So with that, we'll get started. The target audience for this, just to set expectations, is anyone looking to build a mobile application. Doesn't matter the platform. It could be iOS, could be Android, could be Windows. If you want to use Xamarin, if you want to use HTML, JavaScript, all those are supported. We're going to be demoing mostly in C#, but you know there's plenty of resources available elsewhere. And if you go to www.windowsazure.com/mobile, that'll get you to the documentation center. And then there are flows available for each of those different platforms. If you are downloading the deck, you can also see some helpful links here. You know, the mobile channel on channel 9, a walkthrough that I called out of some API script source control and shared scripts, and then some helpful scenarios on Chris Reisner's website. He's one of our evangelists, and he maintains a really handy web page that has basically lists to every resource you could ever want. Not just, you know, Documentation Center that we officially put out, maintain, and support, but also some great community-submitted samples that he wants to make sure to get a little bit more publicity. And again, just a reminder to join the MVA community. You know, over 1 million members of the community, definitely a lot of great content. You know, the team has been great in putting on Azure Week, but it's also a great way to kind of unify different people who have the same interests and are looking to build similar projects and are tackling similar problems. So definitely join. We have a great sign-up code, and we hope that you'll join us in the future. All right, so in terms of looking at Module 1, the overview, this slide will kind of cover what you're looking at when you think about backends hosted in Windows Azure. You know, any backend hosted in Windows Azure is going to get that scalability that you look for in every part of the cloud. But when you look at the different services within Windows Azure that give you these options, you're going to always be thinking about a trade-off between customizability and then speed of development and ease of maintenance. So you're going to be going all the way from, you know, extremely customizable, everything from which OS patch do I want to accept and when that you get in virtual machines, all the way down to mobile services, which is going to give you a really rapid development time and make maintaining your application a lot easier because the team is going to handle a lot of not just the features you need like authentication and data storage in a scripting environment, but also doing any patching and maintenance that you need to in order if Facebook updates their protocols, we'll handle that behind the scenes in terms of, you know, making sure your authentication continues to work. Whereas if you go with, you know, other services in Azure and other cloud providers, you're going to be handling a lot of that yourself. So it is really a trade-off, and you know, it's up to you to kind of decide what's right for your application. But today we're going to focus on mobile services, but because it does really give you that power you need and that scalability, while also some helpers that are going to get you to market a lot faster. You know, definitely want to flag, even though that we're going to be talking about mobile services, that we have customers running in all of these compute models. You know, everything from Glassboard and cloud services, that being web and worker roles, you might be more familiar with that. You know, again, a web role just being a worker role with IIS installed, down to websites and mobile services. So, you know, again, you can run the full gambit, and there are definitely advantages and disadvantages of each choice, but mobile services is probably going to give you the most flexible option you need and be the best fit for pretty much every application. Notification Hubs, which we covered in the first section, is kind of that specialized push service that isn't a compute model itself, but it's a specialized push service that hooks into any application backend, whether that's going to be one of the four we just covered in Windows Azure, or a backend you have hosted on premises. You know, VGTV, which is a large media provider in Norway, uses mobile services to make sure that they can, you know, get everybody, all their customers curated content. So, you know, VGTV didn't want to focus on like, okay, well, how do I set up the SQL database to store all of the favorites? How do I authenticate my users? Do I really want to maintain push for a bunch of different platforms? They didn't. Instead, they wanted to say, how can we focus our team on what they're best at, which is creating content and pushing that out to our customers? And then they let us kind of handle everything that they don't need to be thinking about, all the glue code that really runs behind the scenes so that they can focus on that great user experience. To give you a quick overview of what we're looking at in mobile services, and we're going to dive into each of these separate areas. You know, we have SDKs available for Windows Store, Windows Phone, iOS, Android, as well as HTML5 JavaScript. There's a component available in the Xamarin Store, which Xamarin is a framework that lets you write iOS and Android apps in C#, which is not only great for C# developers in terms who want to reach additional platforms, but it's also really helpful if you want to have a lot of code share in between platforms. Mobile services gives you a really easy way to store data in the cloud. You know, we support a variety of different data models. We're going to give you SQL out of the box, but then also talk through some different options you have. In terms of identity, for consumer-facing applications, we make it really easy to get up and running with Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft account, Google account. And then again, we have Active Directory for more enterprise scenarios that we'll cover in the next session. And of course, custom identity is always an option if you want to go ahead and let users create an account that's specific to your application. And we'll talk through some of the things you would have to do there. In terms of push notifications, you'll see that there is push supported within mobile services for, you know, simple push scenarios, as well as an easy way to use notification hubs, which I again recommend that you check out that session Elio and I just gave if you want a deep dive on that, for the more kind of high volume, low latency push scenarios, whether that be inbox or broadcast. And then all the way to the right, we kind of want to point out that we provide you a scripting environment, not just for table scripts and putting some logic on CRUD operations, so on an insert, delete, what have you, but also a way to do scheduled scripting. If you want to run a job that resizes images every hour, or maybe you want to send a monthly report using report email using SendGrid and mobile services, you can do that. We also have a custom API environment that pretty much lets you NPM install any node module and get off and running with that. Currently, that scripting environment is all Node.js, but we're going to be supporting C# soon. Then, of course, we've mentioned source control because, you know, with massive consumer-facing applications, you're probably going to be working on a team, and that's going to really enable a team environment a lot better than without any source control. So, quickly moving on to section two, supported platforms. You know, we support native development for all the major platforms, as well as have partnerships with Xamarin to give you that, that option for building it for iOS and Android and C#. You know, customers have chosen what works best for them. We have people running in production each of these platforms, taking each of these approaches. Mobile services is really about giving you that flexibility. And as we dive deeper down into the feature set, we'll kind of give you an idea of why different customers went different routes and what some of the things they've learned are. So going on to module three and talking about data, what mobile services does is give you a Windows Azure SQL database right out of the box. When you go through the create new mobile services flow, you're also creating an associated SQL database. We understand that everybody might not want SQL as their primary data store. They might want to connect to an existing database they have, either on premises or maybe in table storage or even SQL Server in a VM. So we do give you the option to connect to those as well. The Azure module for Node.js is going to open the door to those, to table storage, blob storage, anything like that. If you want to kind of utilize SQL Server in a VM or on-prem, Service Bus Relay is a great way to go. And, you know, again, there are trade-offs in data models that we're not going to spend a lot of time talking about today, but that we're happy to answer questions if you have any. But an important thing to mention, and Kirill, this is something I know you always talk about with customers, is how important it is that you retain full control over your data in all these scenarios, and you're getting dedicated resources, and you're not none of this is shared across users, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's there are quite a few offerings out there that are, they may look similar to mobile services, and some of them are pretty famous, popular, like you can mention Parse and a few others. And there's one key difference in the approach to this backend as a service, or a backend in a box, as Scott Hanselman calls it, is in mobile services, while we retain simplicity of creation and retain hands-free management of your of your backend. We take care of your backend for you. You don't need to worry about it. We give you full control over your data. It is your data. You can do anything you want with it. You can run BI on it. It's stored. If it's, you're using SQL, it's stored in your SQL database. Belongs to you. Run any tools. Leverage any tools that are available to your SQL database. It's your power is yours.
Fantastic. I think you were going to give us a little bit of demo about how to actually work with the data in mobile services.
Absolutely,
and what that looks like.
Yeah, let's take a look at it. So let me switch. What we're going to do is we're going to create a mobile service. Many of you may have tried it already. It's very simple to do. It's we're going to give it a name, Great Friday. And we're going to use, as we mentioned, we store data in SQL database by default. It is your SQL database. If you don't have one, we'll help you to create one, but it's going to be always in your control. In this case, I have already a SQL database with me. We're going to create mobile service in one of the regions in the world. Mobile services will be in every region of Windows Azure. Today, it's in every major area in US, Europe, and Asia.
And it's important to point out that you can deploy SQL to any data center you'd like as well. We recommend, obviously, the same as your mobile service, but for customers that might have, you know, the globally distributed user base, they can deploy to multiple data centers.
Oh, absolutely, yes. And so I'll just choose a database for just to avoid changes for the just to avoid charges for the egress between the cross data centers. I'm gonna choose my database that locates it in West US, where I'm creating my mobile service, and I'm gonna specify a password to the database. And off we go. We're going to create a mobile service. What's happened behind the scenes? Now, to you, mobile services will be a backend in a box. Once we create it, which should take less than 30 seconds, you're going to get a bunch of APIs ready to go. And you can call them using our SDK, or you can call them using HTTP client on the platform of your choice. You can use it right away to store data securely in the cloud. You can use it right away to authenticate your users using from Facebook, Google, Twitter, Microsoft account, any popular social identity provider. We recently added Windows Azure Active Directory support. So if you choose, if your choice is to use the to build a line of business application using mobile services, you can easily use mobile services for that as well and authenticate using Azure Active Directory. And behind the scenes, when you hit click create mobile service, we provision a compute environment. We hook it up this compute environment to your SQL backend. We do all these things for you. So once it's completed, as it is right now, you're ready to go. So let's get back to the demo. Now that we have our Great Friday running,
and not
available
to call you out on it, but I see Great Thursday there too. So I think it's Great Week at this point.
We've been on a roll, definitely. So when you create a mobile service, we greet you with a quick start. And you can see here that all these platforms that Miranda talked about that we support, all the native platforms, Windows Store, Windows Phone, iOS, Android, as well as the obviously you can use mobile services from your browser. And very important part, it doesn't have to be a mobile app. It can be a browser app, just wants to call some APIs. In the cloud, and mobile services is a great choice for that. We support cross-domain access cores from the browser. You can use this library from your PhoneGap application. You can use mobile services with Xamarin, which is pretty popular, a cross-platform framework for building iOS, Android, Windows Phone applications. Quick Start helps you building and creating a new app that connects to your mobile service or create an existing one. In our case, we're going to use an existing app that I have and connect it to our new mobile service. Since I'm presenting from my Windows laptop, and you can do the same thing from the Mac or from a laptop of your choice.
And you can point different client applications at the same mobile service, right?
Absolutely.
So if you have an Android app and an iOS app and a Windows app, you're really only using one backend for all of those. So it's cutting down on the amount of code you have to write.
That is a very good point. Yes, absolutely. It's a cross-platform service. You can connect to it from anything. One second. All right. So here I have an app. And it's not much of an app. It's a to-do list. It's a modern Hello World. And it allows me to enter my to-do items. Now, the problem with this app is that it is not connected. Right? So once I close this, it will not remember what to I will not remember for sure, but the app will not remember what my to-do items are. And so if you look at the code within the app, we are storing to-do items in an in-memory collection right here. Let's connect this app to a mobile service. Thanks to our friends in Visual Studio team, we now have a great tools in Visual Studio to work with your mobile services. We're also working with other partners. We'll have similar tooling in other IDEs. But Visual Studio is a great place to build connected apps. And now you can use, let's go to Windows Azure Node. In order to store data in mobile service, we'll need to create a table. On one hand, creating a table in mobile service is really creating a SQL table. But we do a little more than that. Let me create a table. We do a little more than that. We also deploy a web API for you to store data in the table in a secure fashion. So with this just one gesture, you now have an API to store your to-do items. Next thing we're going to do, we're going to connect our Visual Studio client to our client app to the mobile service. Now I can add, we have a NuGet package that has the mobile services SDK. I can add that NuGet package. I can add a few lines of code here and there to connect my app to the mobile service. However, Visual Studio does it even better for me. What I can do is I can use this new add connected service dialog. Look at this beauty. I have all my mobile services right here. I can pick a mobile service of my choice. Today is Friday.
So again, if somebody was doing that at first, they'd have to import a subscription first, their Azure subscription.
That is a good point. Yeah. Just like with any other Windows Azure specific tooling with Visual Studio, mm-hmm. your first step is always import. If you just start on a fresh new laptop, which I hope you do, there are great laptops out there. Your first step is to import a subscription from Windows Azure, import it into Visual Studio, connect it to Windows Azure. Yeah. From there on, the tooling lights up. You can see all of your resources.
And since you get Azure with your MSDN, really no excuse not to have an account anymore.
Yes, absolutely. So we're expecting a flow of mobile services, new mobile services right after this talk. All right, so we're going to choose this great Friday mobile service. And what Visual Studio is going to do is it's going to inject, add a NuGet package to work with mobile services to my solution. It's going to inject a couple lines of code here to connect my app to the mobile service. It's really just a mobile service proxy.
And you it's can important see mobile service client. To mention that key isn't actually a security key at all. It's just a unique identifier for your mobile service, right?
Yes. Yep. Yes, that's true. Yes. It does.
We get that question a lot, so I just thought we'd preempt it.
So while you're developing your app, it keeps your data secure,
yep.
right? Because no one else knows this key.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as you deploy your app to the store, everyone will be able to fetch it. So you do want, before you deploy your app to the store, you always want to add authentication to your mobile service, which we'll show in a later episode. All right, so now we connected our mobile service, and in few lines of code, we can add and start storing data and querying data
mm-hmm.
right from our app. Here we have a proxy to our table. Let's resolve quickly our namespaces. All right, and really straightforward is to insert the item . Everything needs to be async. Very similarly, you can in one line, you can query items.
So now, Kirill, this is probably also a good time to talk about dynamic schema. During development, obviously a great feature that you can toggle on and off so that, you know, really whatever fields you submit are going to automatically be created in your SQL database. You don't ever have to actually specify a schema. Of course, you do want to turn that off once you go to production because your users could have a little bit of fun with your database.
Definitely. So what we are doing here, let me run this and I'll use the concept of dynamic schema will be most obvious to you. So with a couple lines of code, we added mobile. We connected our app to mobile services, and we enabled it to store data now in the cloud. So when we run it, and I add my most popular product,
but notice buy milk is gone.
Now if we go back, we'll see in our mobile service. We'll see that item right here.
Perfect.
Notice that you have this data model here. We just created a table. We didn't specify any schema, and you have this data model here. Mobile services in development time helps you to not worry about schematizing your data, and you'll call us and send us JSON objects, and we'll augment the schema as you go, based on the data that you're storing in us. Once you're in production, of course, you want to disable that behavior. That behavior is called dynamic schemas, as Miranda mentioned. And it's a great thing during development. I love it because I don't have to worry about my schema anymore. I don't need to go and define it anywhere. But in production, you may want to avoid people randomly creating additional columns in your database. So in few clicks, in few minutes, we connected a client, absolutely silly app, to a mobile service, and now it's actually a practical to-do list manager.
Great.
And we can continue with our...
And like Kirill mentioned, you know, you want to add authentication to an application, especially consumer-facing, not just for personalized content, but in order so you can better track what your users are doing and make sure that you're giving them the best possible experience. So in mobile services, what we've done is we've really made it easier to work with the most popular identity providers. You know, we have turnkey support for Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft, Google, and Active Directory. We'll talk about Active Directory in another session. But really, all you have to do is copy over your credentials. And from there, you're off and running with the helpers we give you to just easily pull up that OAuth page where they can submit their credentials securely, and then they have an identity within your application. One question we get a lot is, you know, we support all these out-of-the-box third-party authentication providers, but what if I want to use GitHub, which, you know, we don't say have a turnkey solution for that within the portal. We also get a question, what if I want to do custom authentication so a user can provide an authentication with email and password specific to my app? Those are absolutely supported. We just don't, promote them as turnkey where you just copy over your credentials. What you have to do for custom authentication or any additional third-party auth provider you might be interested in is just go through a pretty easy process using source control and shared scripts. And chrisreisner.com has those samples available. He has a couple sample apps that are going to be published to both the iOS App Store and the Google Play Store soon. And in those, he uses custom identity as the authentication option just to kind of provide some substantive code samples for you guys to use in your own applications. To see kind of, you know, what does it look like if you don't want to go with the turnkey solution we provide you out of the box? What if you want to extend the platform a little bit? And that's, again, something we really wanted to make sure we built into mobile services is that it's not just what are we handing you, but it's what are we really enabling you to build, you know, and when you're going to be building something new, how easy is it going to be? And that's something we really focused on.
I wanted to add to that. That's an important principle that we put in place when we started with mobile services. Is while we want to make everything super easy, we want to take your mind off the backend while you're focusing on your client experience. At the same time, we do not want to stay in your way as you build out your application. And so while we added the turnkey support for authentication with most popular identity providers, or we added a turnkey way of storing structured data in the cloud, or doing a bunch of other things right in mobile services, it is a thin veneer on top of the existing Windows Azure capabilities. And you can change our behavior very easily. You can add your own behavior. You can add your own custom identity. You can add a different storage provider instead of SQL. You have full freedom to do anything you want with the platform.
Great. And you know, part of that, obviously, in that having access to that suite of Windows Azure services is notification hubs. So in this module, what we're going to talk a little bit more about is push notifications. You know, we definitely get a question about that, you know, pushing mobile services versus pushing notification hubs. And it's important to note that, you know, we provide out-of-the-box support for Windows Store, Windows Phone, Android, and iOS notifications in both mobile services and notification hubs. You know, if you watched the first session where Elio and I went through kind of how to get up and running with notification hubs, you saw how easy it was there. The same thing holds for mobile services. You're really just uploading your credentials and going push.apns.send and specifying a payload if you'd like. What we recommend, though, is when you're really thinking about a consumer-facing application that's going to have to scale to tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of users, you want to make sure that you have that specialized service. And that's why we made it so easy for notification hubs to work in conjunction with mobile services. And we really recommend that when you're thinking about kind of providing the best experience, the most personalized experience, the lowest latency experience, that you're using notification hubs for push and kind of offloading all that work to a service that's specialized and that's ready to handle that and just that. Another question we typically get, so we wanted to make sure we flagged, is that, you know, we provide this out-of-the-box support and, you know, fields that are really easy to find for iOS, Android, and Windows. But like Carol said, we're all about enabling, you know, the next step in your application. So our can you build out Mac OS Maverick notifications? Absolutely. If you want to work with Kindle and ADM, fantastic. The same holds for mobile services and notification hubs. We definitely have customers who have kind of extended what we have available to other platforms. And because all the SDKs are available on GitHub, they have really great guidance and helpers for how to do that and how to start building that extensibility in a way that's congruent with what's already available. And again, it's that Azure module for Node.js that's going to open the door to using notification hubs and mobile services. And we're going to work on even making that integration tighter as we go forward. It's probably worth covering again very quickly, even though we talked about it in the other session, that, you know, push notifications introduce a lot of challenges that are probably going to be pretty new for a developer that might be more familiar with the web. You know, everything from cross-platform, you're working with different platform push notification providers. You know, iOS and Apple has one, Windows and Microsoft has one, Android and Google has one, and they all have different protocols. So if you think about kind of what's most efficient in working with one, it's not always going to be what's true for working with all three, especially if you're going from one to three. So having a service that's optimized for that cross-platform scenario is going to be really helpful. Also, targeting based on location and interest, hugely helpful. You know, when you think about interest can be something like time zones too. You know, you don't want to be broadcasting a notification to everybody in the middle of the night. You probably want to send batches based on, you know, what time of day is most appropriate and what users are interested in hearing about. In terms of personalization, again, that's something you can get a huge in-depth walkthrough of from the notification session. But what you're going to be doing is when you think about kind of how to send based on interest tags, those are sending a message that you want to make sure a certain set of users gets. But then once it gets to those users, the templates help kind of make sure that it arrives in the format that they want to see. You know, is it in the right currency? Is it displaying Celsius or Fahrenheit? Is the notification in the correct language? Is it formatted for their device? So you can see that there's easily some crossover between tags and templates. But when you think about kind of what fits and where, think about, you know, anything that's determining who's getting the notification should be a tag. Anything that's determining formatting once the notification already gets to the right person is a template. And that high volume, low latency, especially in consumer scenarios that we're talking about today, is really why you want to focus on using notification hubs for that scalability. It's really, really difficult to achieve massive scale with low latency in an efficient way, right? Because if you wanted to do the same thing that we provide you in notification hubs, you'd probably have a lot of idle VMs hanging around for a long time, or you'd have to over-provision your backend if you didn't offload it to a specialized service. And then, of course, maintaining an accurate device handle registry. You want to flag how important that is, and it's something that most developers don't realize until it's a problem. You know, you're responsible as an app developer for making sure that if somebody uninstalls your app, you aren't continuing to try to send them push notifications. That's why it's so important to maintain an accurate registry. And notification hubs is going to give you a lot of help with that, that maybe you won't get a mobile services push. So when you think about, you know, how do I use these together, you know, actually using the compute and provisioning resources and thinking about kind of having an environment for scripting and a way to add authentication, mobile services is giving you that. But when you think about kind of using that for with push notifications too, you want to have a specialized service there as well. And this is a quick notification hubs overview that just kind of covers what we talked about, everything from making sure only users who are registered to specific tags are getting those notifications. And again, tag expressions allow you to use any Boolean expression with tags, so you know, and, not, or, to target the exact group you want. All the way over to templates on the client side, you can see the different currencies there. And it's gonna, what all you're doing is sending a single call from your app backend for every like bundle of content. So think of it that way in terms of efficiency and making sure that you can scale too. I think that we're going to probably skip this in the interest of time, or do you want to do it quickly?
I think it's worthwhile to show just an example.
Great.
How would you extend your mobile service with any functionality that we just
Let's
talked about?
Let's do it, yeah.
How do you use that scripting environment?
Mm-hmm.
So just in case, we're going to get back to our mobile service right here. Just in case you haven't tried this yet, in mobile services, the way you add your logic is you add scripts. You can add scripts as the additional logic to CRUD operations performed against your tables. So if I go here on the items, I can go to script tab, and I can override behavior that happens on insert, update, delete, or read. And I can add any type of logic here, including sending push notifications or posting on Twitter or doing any other stuff. So what we're going to do, the other thing that is important is that while you can use Windows Azure Portal to edit your scripts, beyond a couple lines of code, it's probably gets problematic. What we offer you is work with your scripts on your laptop in an IDE environment of your choice, and use source control to track your changes. You can enable source control right here on the dashboard. Set up source control. After that, you can use Git to push data. Git is supported by TFS. You can, of course, use GitHub, any of the place where you want to manage your scripts. And you can work with your scripts in the IDE of your choice, and you can Git push updates to a mobile service. And I think we're going to show more of this to you in our next episode. In terms of adding notification hubs, mobile services does provide you push API that you can use inside your scripts right here. But if you want to use notification hubs and get additional functionality of push, you can just use Windows Azure module. And it's available to you in your scripting environment. And just call Windows Azure module includes APIs to work with the notification hubs. As right here, you can create notification hubs proxy. You can add the connection point to your connection string to your notification hubs. And from there on, you can use notification hubs API and just keep pushing.
And it's good to note that, you know, even though the Azure module we've already pre-baked it into the scripting along with SendGrid, any node module they want to use, they can just NPM install it.
Absolutely. Yeah, let's show this in our next episode.
All right, sounds good. So moving on to cover extensibility, this is a great segue from what you were just talking about in terms of the scripting. Source control and NPM really opened the door to the entire suite of first-party Azure services. You know, anything from notification hubs, which we've talked a lot about, to blob storage or table storage, even HD Insight. And then when you think about access to third-party services in the store, you know, we've done a lot of work with some great partners at SendGrid, at Twilio, at New Relic, to really expand what we offer developers in terms of the platform. And what's great about the Windows Azure Store, where so many of them are available, is you can create an account and provision third-party resources right within Windows Azure, and then also receive a bill if you go beyond the free tier, right on your same Windows Azure bill. So you're not having that kind of scenario where it's pretty common in this API economy where you're trying to glue together a bunch of different bills to try to figure out what your usage is everywhere and track a bunch of different accounts. We've really made a big investment in trying to bring everything you need right to where you are instead of making you go find it elsewhere. And then again, just to flag, you know, any node module you that exists, the thousands out there, you can just npm install it using source control that we have via Git. And you're off and running. And you know, if you put that in shared scripts, you can share methods across different scripts. So if you want to maybe use the same one in schedule scripts as you do in an insert operation on a certain SQL database table, you can absolutely do that. And just a little flag for some of our great partners. Twilio obviously expands the feature set to add SMS and voice to your applications. New Relic, we have a great integration with them right within the Windows Azure portal for adding some, providing developer analytics and some performance monitoring of your iOS and Android applications. Pusher powers kind of real-time communications. And SendGrid, of course, for email, which is so important to every application, even if it's just something as simple as, you know, confirming the successful creation of an account. And Auth0 for a variety of those authentication providers we talked about. We showed you kind of what we support out of the box, talked through how you can get up and running with any other third-party authentication provider or custom identity system you'd like. But if you're looking for another person who kind of provides a turnkey experience, Auth0 is a great partner of ours that makes sure that that's easy to do as well. So to close, we wanted to make sure we flag some best practices as well as pointed you towards some resources that we think might be helpful. So in mobile services, it's just really important to make sure that you're familiar with SQL basics as you scale. You know, a lot of the questions we get, which we're happy to answer, but you know, we want to make sure that we kind of get this information out there as much as possible so you're not running into problems. Because by the time you get to us, you've probably had a couple issues already, and we want to try to forerun those. Just, you know, check the basics. You know, are you indexing the right columns? Are you running a query analyzer to make sure that everything looks okay with the queries you're writing? You know, check your data model. You know, have somebody else check your data model too. If you're thinking about you know, a very popular consumer-facing app, especially one that's globally distributed, think about caching so that data that needs to be accessed most frequently is has lower latency to that access time. You know, Azure table versus SQL database, there are definitely trade-offs of both, but if you don't need that rich querying ability from Windows Azure SQL database, you know, Azure table storage might provide a better option in certain scenarios, and certainly for pushing your logs there. You know, SQL database premium, if you need to, if you are really getting a lot of traction and you have a lot of activity and you need better better throughput, that's something to look into. And then partitioning always. Do you want to talk through some of the notification hubs best practices?
Sure, absolutely. In general, notification hubs is the way we recommend you do push notifications from your apps. Helps you in many ways. You don't need to deal directly with the individual push notification providers from different platforms, WNS, APNS, GCM. You don't have to deal with those protocols. You don't have to deal with those formats, etc., or with the dealing with retries, retry logic, etc. Notification hubs has virtually unlimited scale because it's very easy for us to add workers on demand, and so you don't need to worry about scaling out your push solution. And you can use things like tags to in notification apps to do work to make your application work with just logical users and groups of users, and not, you don't have to deal with the physical device handles in your application. Which helps you with relieving you from management these millions of records that of mapping between logical users and device handles, or groups of users and device handles. Notification apps has a great slew of features around personalization of your messages, great telemetry. It's a fully beefed up, if you will, notification solution that solves a lot of problems for you. If you're using mobile services and you need push and you need a large volume of it, I would recommend to use notification hubs for mobile services as well. In fact, we are working on making these two solutions integrated much better. So the notification hubs is a push functionality available in mobile services.
Great. And just to point you towards some resources, these are going to definitely be available in the deck that you can download. But mobile services resources, we definitely want to flag. That second link, aka.ms/commonwams, That's that collection of really helpful links Chris Reisner maintains. It's not just kind of documentation center content, but also community-driven samples. Same for notification hubs. You know, this is going to be available for download, but if you go to www.windowsazure.com and documentation, you'll be able to navigate easily to the Notification Hub Center or the Mobile Services Center. So we do want to thank you for joining us today and learning a little bit more about how to build scalable consumer-facing applications in Azure. You know, we're going to be coming back, both of us, for the next episode, focusing more on secure applications in the enterprise and how to really empower your workforce. But I do want to thank you for this, and we'll see you soon.
Thanks, Tom. Thank you, guys.